Ladies and gentlemen, we ask that you would turn your cell phones off or put them on vibrate for the program this morning. I'd like to acknowledge the American Legion Band for their musical contribution to this morning's program. And now please rise, if you are able, for the presentation of the colors. The presentation of the colors is being executed by a World War I United States Army Color Guard. Please remain standing for the national anthem and the invocation. Captain of the Guard, present the colors.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Would you join me in prayer? Great God and King, we are grateful for thy loving kindness and grace that thou hast bestowed upon us as a nation. Today we honor those to whom honor is due, our comrades in arms from World War I. With the passing of Frank Buckles, so passes a generation of heroes. We have received that which they passed on to us, a free country, paid for and preserved by the sacrifices of those nearly 5 million men and women who served America in that era. While they're gone, they're not forgotten, and so we commit this ceremony to their honor in your holy name. Amen.
Please take your seats. My name is Steve Van Buskirk, representing the Veterans of Foreign Wars National Headquarters. It is my honor to serve as your Master of Ceremonies today. Please help me welcome Brian Alexander, President and Chief Executive Officer of the National World War I Museum.
Thank you, Steve. Good morning and welcome, everyone. On behalf of the Museum's Board of Trustees, we're grateful that you could join us on this special day. We gather here today to pay tribute to a generation that faithfully served our country and whose sacrifices forever changed America. And it's fitting that this ceremony, which honors all Americans who served in the First World War, take place in the shadow of the Liberty Memorial. More than 90 years ago, Kansas City gave an extraordinary gift to the people of this nation when they raised the funds to build the Liberty Memorial, the only memorial in our nation dedicated to all Americans who served. When reflecting on the memorial, General John J. Pershing wrote, "This memorial symbolizes the obligation that rests upon present and future generations to preserve that for which those men and women offered their all, and for many of whom the supreme sacrifice was accepted. May their memory live on, and may every American who looks upon this noble edifice be inspired by their devotion. Atop the tower, you'll see four guardian spirits that symbolize the qualities that Liberty Memorial seeks to inspire: courage, honor, patriotism, and sacrifice. The Americans who served during the First World War exemplified these attributes, and with the passing of the last doughboy, we pause to pay tribute to this generation. Frank Woodruff Buckles, the last living American doughboy, died about 2 weeks ago at the age of 110. In 2008, the National World War I Museum invited Mr. Buckles, a Missouri native, back to his home state for the 2008 Memorial Day observance. It was a remarkable experience to tour the museum with someone who'd actually taken part in the Great War, and even though he had served more than 90 years before, he described his experiences vividly and with great poignancy. Later that weekend, I was sitting beside Mr. Buckles and his daughter, Susanna, during the Kansas City Symphony's Celebration Cessation event, when the crowd realized that he was in attendance. More than 40,000 people gave a standing ovation to pay their respects. This morning we received a note from the Buckles family for me to read. Mr. Buckles' family looks forward to joining all those who will pay tribute to the generation that gave so much in what was known once as the Great War. Will you now please join me in a moment of silence to honor Frank Woodruff Buckles and the more than 4 million Americans who served during the Great War? Thank you. Sergeant Alvin C. York of Pall Mall, Tennessee, was one of the most decorated soldiers of the Great War. He was awarded the Medal of Honor by General John J. Pershing for leading 7 of his men on a daring attack on an enemy machine gun nest. As a result of this attack, 4 German officers, 128 men, and several guns were captured. Please help me now in welcoming George York, the son of a great American World War I hero, to share his thoughts with us today.
Good morning. I would like to say a few words to you if I can break enough icicles off them until I get started. I had a cold in the motel, but I didn't think it would. According to the weather we had yesterday, it's right the opposite of what it was when we got here yesterday. But it's good to be here anyway. Good to see this good number so interested in what's going on in the world and the past and today, and hopefully good for the future. I'd like to say a few words about my dad. My dad was very patriotic, as you all know, and I guess a little of it rubbed off on me. And I hope I have passed it down to the next generation, and I hope he passes it on down to the next one. There's 3 generations of us present here today, my son and my granddaughter and her husband. And I hope I leave a legacy behind me that will help them to realize that in spite of all the problems that our country has, we are still the greatest nation in the world. I wouldn't want to live in any other land than America. We're here today in memory of passing of the last serviceman of World War I. Of course, we all know, if we know anything about history, that it was a time that when the armistice was signed, it's supposed to be in the end of all wars. And then come the Great Depression, and Then we saw a division somewhat over our country over World War II. Nobody wants to fight. Reading in my dad's diary, he said, I didn't want to fight, but he said, I would rather fight them on their soil than for them to come and we have to fight them on our soil. And nobody loves war, but there's no way you're going to get immune to war unless we just fold up our tents and stay home and let the enemy come and take us away. Then we saw the division, and there was a question over the Korean War, which then there came the Vietnam War, which I guess there was more division in our country over that war than any other. And there still remains in the doubt of a lot of people of what we accomplished during that time when we did not win and we came home after losing 58,000 of our servicemen and women. But anyway, be that as it may, in the past, I think our servicemen and women deserved as much honor and recognition from that war that, as they did any other war. Whether we agree whether we agree that all that was involved in it, we still 100% support our men and women around the world. We saw kind of a resurgence of patriotism in 9/11. Seemed like all of our people seemed to come together more than they had in the past. We sit back and kind of in our easy chair and watch things. Sometimes I think America is too soft and overlook a lot of things of importance that might save the lives of our men and women. And I just wonder sometimes when I read about the fall of the Twin Towers and how it came about. And I read not long ago where there's still 18 human body parts that not yet have been identified. And we look back at that, and when it first happened, people seemed to be stirred and interested and patriotic and come together. But it didn't take very long for them to fall back in the same attitude that they live in a lot of times. It can't happen to us, but it did. It happened. And it can happen again if we don't stay on the alert. The man that we honor today come to the end of a generation, a war, as I said, that was supposed to end all wars, but it did not, and it will not. But I remember when my dad, as a young boy, my dad used to take his pistol and go out and shoot it straight up in the air, celebrating the signing of the armistice. And I'm glad today that we still have our freedom. I'm glad today that we still honor our servicemen and women. And my dad served in World War I. My son, my brother and I in World War II. My son in the Vietnam War. My grandson in the war in Iraq. He's a doctor, lieutenant colonel at Fort Sam Houston in Texas. And it all comes down the line. And I hope that all of us here today can hold the torch high of what we've been taught and been told and stand for America, which stands for freedom of religion and rights and freedom and religion for all. Thank you.